side, it's time to feed the brain a bit. This is a project that really exemplifies the overall theme for the conference, because we don't want it to be just academic, but distance from practice, distance from things happening. We wanted to show how academic research and all the considerations we bring in the teaching actually apply in practice, in things that get printed and produced and distributed and matter to people's lives. And this wouldn't have been a better project, so I'd like to claim some sort of conspiracy to arrange for the timing. It was all entirely coincidental. We're grateful to Harvard University Press for helping us put this event and sponsoring Tim and the other attendees to come here. I will pass the word to you to explain a bit about the project. In your goodie bags, you've had a sampler for the specific project, so that is also the first time that I think this has been distributed in such an audience, so that's another great thanks for making this possible. Tim Jones.
Press doing design and production, and you know, this I'm nervous because I'm not used to speaking to a group like this. We're not usually, designers aren't called out to talk. We start off with the Murty Classical Library of India, which is a fantastic project. It is loosely based on, you might be familiar with Arlo Classical Library, which is Greek and Latin basing page translations, which was called 95 years later by the Italian Renaissance Library, and then the Dumbarton Oaks Medieval Library. In 2010, we were approached to do a library of Indian classics. And when our editor came to me and said, do you think we could do this? I knew it would be really hard, but I vastly underestimated it. And I said, sure, because that tends to be our response in design, in book production. So we took it on in 2010, and I want to start by saying that this couldn't, none of this, this series began with Rohan Murty, who was incredibly generous in funding it and incredibly passionate about creating it. And then Sheldon Pollack, the general editor of the series, has a depth of knowledge in the field that I think is unmatched. And Charmila Sen, our house, has a tenacity that's got us through the 5 years it took us from creating a fund to launching books that, you know, we wouldn't have gotten here. So in 2010, I began with, oh, so I need to find some Indic fonts. And I started looking. And I looked on the web, and I talked to a few large foundries, and I basically came up with this sort of vague concept of, well, I can come up with, somebody must have come up with one font that will have all of these languages in it, and we'll just use that. And that'll work. And so I started looking into that, and that obviously looked really badly. And meantime, our editor-in-chief shares a backyard with Matthew Carter, which she's never mentioned because all they talk about is their gardening. So she, because she knew how much I was struggling with it, mentioned to him, you know, we're having trouble with this index. And he said, you need to call Fiona Ross. And so I emailed Fiona, and she was incredibly wonderful and gracious to me, and didn't laugh at me when I mentioned some of my initial ideas, that she waited until, I think, 3 months ago to tell me that the fonts that I was interested in had been hacked from her original designs. And then Fiona introduced me to Rathna, Ramanathan, who has been our outstanding designer. Of course, we work with John Hudson, and I also want to mention Titus Nemeth is here tonight, who has been incredible working on it with us on the Indo-Persian books. The Murty Classical Library in India is designed to be perpetual. I think you'll hear this somewhat from Rathna. It's designed to outlive us and to keep going. We have 17 languages under contract, currently being worked on by translators. It's designed to have 3 to 5 new books every year. We're currently on schedule to introduce 8 scripts with Fiona and John, as well as others that we're continuing to work on, and it continues to grow. So it's to say that I've learned a lot about what a lot of you study and already know is a huge understatement. I've been exposed and taught, essentially, by Fiona, John, and Rathna, and Titus, as well as these incredible translators. And I've also learned about what translators sometimes have differences with typographers. But it's been a great experience. It's been, you know, obviously for me it's been a learning experience, but the greatest part of it is that these books are available, they're translated into English, they're available as original scripts, and it's never been done, not on the scale that we hope to achieve. And, you know, there'll certainly be qualms along the way with what we've done, but, you know, low classical library is 103 years old, it still has problems, it still gets retranslated, there's still things being fixed. Hopefully the, you know, 10th person working on this after me will have fixed some of the things that we've encountered. But I'm incredibly proud of the work we've done, and it comes from people like you and what you're studying that gets us to bring these things out. And I can say that we were in India for 4 launch events, and the, especially again for an academic press, the amount of attention and enthusiasm and passion for these books was stunning to me. I mean, the international press was there. I've never been to a book launch for one of our books that had 18 photographers. So it really is rewarding, and from my perspective, it couldn't have happened without this team, and certainly couldn't have happened if it hadn't started with Matthew Carter talking over a fence about the amazing professor.
From the first, it was really important for us to hear about the vision that Rohan Murty and Harvard University Press had regarding this project. So we wanted to know about the anticipated look and feel of the books, the intended global readership, and the range of literature and languages and scripts. Rathna and John will go into further detail about how aspects of this vision impacted on the design and production processes of the type and typography of both the Indian and Latin text, and of course, the Persian setting too. Well, with regard to the Indian scripts, the project brief immediately spoke to me of creating type designs possessing a modern, contemporary feel with traditional, that is, classical proportions. We needed to find a visual voice that would speak to today's young readers, as well as accurately represent to scholars the literatures they had long revered. And these were to be original designs that were compatible with the chosen Latin typeface in terms of texture. We intended to adopt a coherent and cohesive design approach to all scripts, whilst remaining true to their inherent and individual characteristics. And this is an approach that John and I followed before with regard to other projects. Since my student days, I felt that the beautiful literature of India had too often been ill-served by typography. The often exquisite and visually expressive scripts that represent the multiplicity of languages having been poorly represented in print, except by a few publications from notable founders during the hand composition period, such as the bottom one here. Here was a fantastic opportunity to do justice to the literature, the languages, and the scripts. Well, that was our hope. At the outset, we needed to consider the nature of the texts and the range of the scripts that would be eventually undertaken. And this was going to be a truly collaborative venture. And we benefited greatly from the expertise and information provided to us by Harvard, particularly from Tim and Adriana, who also provided us with feedback from the editorial board, the compositors, and not least the translators, some of whom I knew from my sellout, It's a Small World, and particularly Professor Christopher Shackle, who's here, we're delighted he's here, for the Punjabi text. The range of scripts was broad, but did not include any with which we were not already familiar. And this just shows some of the ones that we did at Linotype, so any of my fellows who's here. And happily, a number of the proposed classical texts were also familiar to me and to Rathna. So, I'm deliberately not showing you much of the Murty types because I don't want to steal the thunder from that, you know, job. There's only one showing of the Murty himself. So, as in almost all of the typeface design projects which I've been involved, research is the initial phase. And of the anticipated first set of publications, the following involve new Indian scripts designs. So, Hindi, which we had a Devanagari script, so the first one there. Punjabi, which is the Gulmukhi script, as you can see there. Tamil, Telugu, and Bengali. And of these, the Hindi, Punjabi, and Telugu classical texts have been published. So I'm just going to briefly focus on these, on the inception of the Indian script typefaces for these publications tonight. And it's worth possibly mentioning that although the Indian languages may stem from two language groups, aside from those that make use of the Arabic or Perso-Arabic writing systems, all Indian scripts derive from the same origin, namely the Brahmi script. Yes, we have another map. We have lots of maps today. These, therefore, show affinity to each other, possess their own characteristics. They derive from Brahmi, which we discussed earlier. I know this is not really legible, but you get the impression of how many there are, and other people have shown the slides earlier today. So John suggested I speak very briefly about the phonology, the arrangement of the scripts, in case people are unaware of this. So, the scripts comprise syllabaries arranged according to the Indian phonological system, in which an inherent vowel is present, although not always pronounced in speech. And the character set is then expanded by the use of consonants with different vowels other than the inherent vowel, that may be created by different means, for instance, combining vowels, signs, or ligatures, and also by the use of consonantal clusters that are represented as single syllables. This is actually from the first Sanskrit grammar book that I was given when I sort of trodden water, put my toes in the water of Sanskrit when I was doing a university. This is from Stenzler, and it just gives me the basics of the idea. So one can have single syllables that represent consonant clusters, which then may take vowel signs. Here the subscript is a vowel sign. And they're often stacked to show, this is in the Bengali typeface, and which in turn may take different vowels. Anyway, given the nature of this writing system, the size of the character sets can vary a great deal depending on the language, complexity of the text, and even language or regional preferences. And by the way, I always forget to say this, but all Indian scripts are unicase. They read from left to right, and the graphic representation of vowels is not optional. Here we have, I've just put this up to show some of the typographic features that one might want to consider for Bengali script, which you'll see represent some of the features from the North Indian. Therefore, the literary texts needed to be studied to anticipate the character set. For example, we knew that the literary Hindi would not have the same character set as the Nimala Devanagari UI font. I showed you the UI font earlier. So we needed to envisage the patterns on the page, which would also differ whether it be prose or poetry. And Sanskrit text, we had to anticipate, although that wasn't the immediate publication, hasn't happened yet, we realized that with condenser than Hindi. This is actually from, this is Balmaharsha Charitam, which will be published. This is actually from the text I studied for my Sanskrit finals. And this is part of the sentence, whole sentence. So it gives you an idea. We needed to consider mixed script setting environments in the note sections as well, which might share the same punctuation as the latter. So our customary starting point on any project has been to start with a sample set of about 7 characters for each script. And these would contain the most frequent characters, always ka, which is auspicious in Sanskrit, and Bengali, which is like, and the tallest, deepest, and the most complex characters. In doing so, we can generate mock samples to represent the design, and we consider the weight, the dimensions, the fitting, and the overall texture of the intended typeface. And so for Murty text, we knew that we would need the typeface to work at text sizes and also note sizes. And this obviously is not an initial test, it's one of the early tests, but it's obviously got more than 7 characters. So when we were considering the Devon Agri, it was clear that a typeface like Adobe Devon Agri was unsuitable to speak to the intended vast readership. In some eyes, it would be considered too modern and cursive, perhaps too characterful. Whereas the font like the Linotype Devon Agri was too condensed, having been designed primarily for newspaper setting, and a few of the forms might look a little antiquated, and looks like we show here, but maybe possessing too high a contrast. So the first iteration of Linotype Bengali was the film setting, which had been designed by Matthew Carter, and I think was mentioned earlier. And this was based on the fonts selected by Walter Tracy, produced for the renowned Ninaya Saga Press, and had been published, or rather, produced by the Jawaji G Type Foundry. And so it was to this foundry that produced quality typefaces, particularly as it states here, the Sanskrit, Hindi, and Marathi, that we looked again for inspiration with regard to the styling and the proportions of the Devon Agri fonts, whilst avoiding some of the outdated styles. They have particularly narrow, some of the characters are particularly narrow. So we liked the robustness that we had achieved in the Adobe Devon Agri and the more generous counters. And furthermore, our experience with the Adobe design had shown the benefits of including a large array of consonantal clusters, carefully designed conjuncts, in other words. And so we decided that rather than creating these from components, that we would actually work on drawing these. And it's a bit like, I think, Sarah's earlier talk, in order for things to look the same, they have to be different. So some of the combinations may look like they've got common components, but there's subtle differences to make them readable. So our conjunct set, I just counted it about 9 years, I never remember the numbers, amounted to about 500 conjuncts in Hindi. Yet we knew that although the Hindi text would be published first, the intention would be to publish Sanskrit texts. And in most Sanskrit texts, the frequency of conjuncts is much greater. The inter-word spacing or inter-phrase breaks are fewer. There is a preference for the use of more orthodox conjunct forms that stack vertically, and all of which combine to render a very different and dense textual impression to that of Hindi text. And it was also useful to anticipate the requirements for the Sanskrit composition, so that additional conjuncts and marks, as well as alternative shapes, would form a natural expansion to the Hindi design. So in other words, we would not have to overhaul the Devon Agri design and fitting in order to accommodate Sanskrit at a later date. So here, everything on the left is exactly the same consonantal cluster as everything on the right. The left being preferred for Hindi, and the right for Sanskrit. And it's the same with the bottom right as well. So, As we have done in the case of Adobe Denmark, in addition to a wide range of printed material, we consulted manuscripts to look at character relationships, to review the positioning of vowel signs and other marks, so that we looked at the manuscripts because they had no technological restrictions. It was just limited to the skill and choices of the manuscript copyist. And for this, we're particularly indebted to the British Library and with respect to the upcoming Sanskrit release to the Sanskrit editor. Curator Pasquale Manzo. Well, in the case of the Gurmukhi script typeface for Punjabi text, we are specially indebted to the British Library, the curator Dr. Marina Cignini, as well as Professor Christopher Shackle, who translated the Sufi lyrics of Willie Shah. And here the character set did not present a problem. Generally speaking, Gurmukhi character sets are quite well defined, number fewer than 200 sorts. But the challenge was to develop a style that was in keeping with the designs for the other scripts and in harmony with the facing page English translation. And most North Indian manuscripts are produced with the use of a broadening pen, reed pen, that is cut in the opposite direction to that used for the Latin. And this produces the characteristic stroke modulation of Indian lettering, in which bowls at junctions to verticals thicken, and the stress of the counters differ from Western lettering. And even in a low contrast typeface, one would not thin, whereas you'd expect that in something like a lettering, for instance. So this modulation has translated directly into type, this which was originally from manuscript sources, as the types of Jawaji, Dajaji, and Ibi demonstrate. However, in Punjabi typography, in the Gurmukhi script, even for the printing of devotional literature as well as newspaper publications, the preference of the mid-20th century has been for low contrast typefaces. Such style, though, was out of keeping with our intentions, and we therefore felt it important to consult the original manuscript tradition to assist us in developing a new approach to Gurmukhi typeface design. This is from 1930, and this is the Linotype 1 and 4 newspaper version. John and I were given the exceptional privilege of consulting manuscripts in the British Library, especially selected for us by Marina and Christopher, and should review them under their expert guidance. And we spent a considerable amount of time analysing the different styles that were apparent, evidently from the different scribal traditions that had influence in the Punjab. And the manuscript that took our breath away, and I think we should take yours away, and was the most informative, was the prayer book of Rani Jindal, which the British Library let me show you. I am not allowed to crop it or enlarge it, but it's one. So we looked at the construction of the letter forms and the stroke modulation. And Christopher was kind enough to provide us with feedback as the typeface developed and to advise us on the development of particular stylistic sets to prevent clashes of ascendants with superior marks. Lastly, the development of the Telugu typeface. This took us down another route. And it's interesting to note the manuscripts of South India were created by means of stylus and palm leaf, which was then inked. So this method produced monolinear forms. Yet the typography, particularly in Kannada and Tamil scripts, show a long-held predilection to have high contrast forms, which they really delight in. So we were considering something along a middle ground here. I think I've given you enough of this slide for now, so I will be on. So the Linotype font Tamara, in which I was involved in designing some decades ago with my fellows, had lower contrast than we desired. Also, we felt it was a bit neat and tidy and readable for newspaper setting, but was seen, you know, weak and a bit characterless in the Murty library. So therefore, we looked at the very elegant metal types of the Swatantra type foundry for inspiration. Really, in the shaping of the counters and the fittings at the top here, so you can look closely at the sample book and see some correspondence with this. And yet, we can consulted the manuscript forms for the sizing of the subscripts. Whilst it was the fitting of the Tara fonts that informed the very tricky spacing of the font, which we are still tweaking. So it's very important to us, as at the beginning, to strive to do justice to the beauty of the literary content and to make these works newly accessible to an international readership is such a worthwhile project. And also, in keeping with the objectives of the project, we're particularly pleased that upon publication of the first book in each of these Indian script typefaces, the fonts are freely available for non-commercial use. I'm now going to hand over to Rathna, but thank you.
And the warmer band for the title of the genre. So I was thinking about this while I was sitting there, and I usually sneak in some Bollywood music. But I feel the smoke on the terrace has already done that job. So I'm going to pretend that I'm in the seminar room next to Charlene's office giving a PG seminar about my PhD. I'm going to ignore you guys, and I'm just going to focus on ones that I can see. So my presentation today is about the process behind the book design and production for Murty type books. And while I aim to give you a sense of the thinking behind the design concept, I think it's really important that we acknowledge that design is shaped by its context and considerations of audience. So my presentation is divided into these three categories. I'm keenly aware that whilst I stand here alone presenting the process behind the book design and production, this project is truly a collaborative one, which has spanned five continents. So Tim, we need to look for Africa and Antarctica. So I'm representing a sizable number of people, typographers, book designers, programmers, XML vendors, printers, binders, and multiple other book design and production experts. For me, the Murty project has a personal significance. I grew up in India, and I did both my schooling and undergraduate degree there. So Rohan Murty's vision for Murty Library, which came from his own experience of education in India, was something that really I identified with. The text that I studied in school was Shakespearean comedies and tragedies, poems from Wordsworth and Shelley, stories by Hardy and Kipling. And this is a rich heritage that has brought me a wealth of understanding about the world I inhabit now. But keenly missing from it was the same opportunity to partake of my own heritage. The classics in Harvard, as many of you know, and as Tim has said, has a long-standing tradition with the Law, the Itati, the Dunbar books. And the Murty Library was going to join these ranks. When I started looking at the mission behind the classics at Harvard, I found that the purpose was exactly and beautifully aligned and sympathetic to the Murty cause. And this began to identify a starting point for the audiences for whom the book design was intended, and suggested an approach that was also in alignment with the worthy ideologies of Harvard University Press. However, what drew me to this project were three situations. The second was a statement made by Sheldon Pollock, editor of the series at the General Literary Festival, which identified a critical need to address a situation where Indians and the rest of the world would not have access to India's classical heritage. The second situation is described by two statements made more than 50 years apart, talking about the same thing. The first is by C.D. Deshmukh and refers to a lack of attention being paid to printing and typography in many interventions in India. The second, more recent statement by Kriya Ramakrishnan, an academic publisher in Chennai, loudly bemoans the lack of standards for typesetting in modern Indian languages. In 2011, Jack Scholes and Timo Arnold wrote on the I Magazine blog about something they called change through making. They noted that we as designers need to keep in mind that we can design the means through which design happens, challenging the concepts, behaviors, and means of production, as well as designing form. And the chance to be a part of the Murty Library project gave us exactly this opportunity. So while this is about the Murty Library, this is also importantly about a typography for India. For the purpose of today's talk, I will speak specifically about these five considerations, limiting myself solely to the interior design of the books. But I'd like to take a moment here to acknowledge the obvious. At our first meeting at Harvard University back in 2010, Fiona and I were very keen that we take a photograph of the team. Her for purpose of history, me because I knew I was never going to look as good as I did there. It was my 43rd birthday yesterday. This is a 100-year publishing project. I'm going to be dead. So this remit made it really essential that the system being created survived us, made sense to the people beyond us, and provided whoever takes this on in the future with a strong foundation to build on. So one of our important considerations is to build a set of language templates based on genre that we can slowly hand over and share with others working and facing the same challenges in the Indian context. One of my first tasks was to find on the project was to find a compatible Latin typeface for the books. And the list of criteria that John, Tim, Fiona, and I sat down and discussed, put together, was as follows. There are many kind folks here who trusted us and sent us typefaces that we could conduct tests with. David Brezhina, Fred, Eric Munger, Hendrik Hubel, Jeremy Tankard, Titus, Tom, Victorian, amongst others. In addition to this criteria, I also wanted a generous and robust typeface that could flourish with the best that US printing had to offer, but also withstand not so great printing conditions in India. Using the short list of typefaces created using this criteria, we conducted tests with Latin typefaces, Adobe DevHungry, the Tamil Beta typeface, and thus name doesn't leak. The typesetting was done in keeping with the layout and specifications of the Dunbar Oak series. And the size and leading of the Latin typeface was decided based on its relationship to the Devanagari, and then slightly adjusted. And slightly adjusted the Tamil and Persian pages. At this stage, the focus was on the comparative relationships of the Latin page with the Indic rather than any microtypographic details. Our final choice was Hendrik Hubel's Antwerp, a classic and contemporary text typeface with historical references. Antwerp has a generous XI which allowed for reading on the printed page and on the screen. It has multiple number styles, including old style figures, large set of ligatures and fractions, punctuation, slightly inclined stems, pronounced ink traps. Importantly, as the series adheres to Indic conventions of typefaces having only one weight, the Latin needed to have a distinct Roman and italic for compatibility. There was a good color and weight match with Devanagari and Nastali, and good comparisons with the Tamil typeface. Importantly, Antwerp, while drawing from history, had a distinctly contemporary feeling. It could be set in small sizes and work equally as well as footnotes or display type. Whilst Fiona and John got on with the hard task of designing the Indic typefaces, I started to look at building a book design concept. The first consideration were the different languages and genres. That the book design had to accommodate. Earlier Harvard classics had dealt with 3 to 4 different languages. The Murty task was to accommodate at least the starting mission of 30 different languages and relevant scripts. The concept of unity and diversity is promoted very strongly in India and is exemplified by the national anthem written by Tagore. This is a guiding principle for the approach to the interior design, that is, by exemplifying the best of the scripts and at the same time being relevant to the larger needs of the series. For the purpose of the book design, we divided Indic scripts into 3 subgroups, North and South Indic and Persia Arabic. Each has a different writing system and different typesetting conventions. Fiona spoke about this. But the aim is to establish a series of typographic conventions that can be followed in the future. And for the purpose of the series, this will take 2 templates and accompanying style guides for each language, presently 1 for poetry and 1 for prose. The other consideration was to keep in mind the different genres. The requirements of prose and poetry, as we know, are different. But sometimes texts come in accompaniment with other texts, which require different micro and macro typographical arrangements. So in order to be robust, the template needed to provide for these possibilities. But how do you begin to anticipate the needs of a 100-year series? You look at good historical practice going back more than a couple of 100 years. We did a tremendous amount of archival research looking at early printed books in India to give us the breadth and scope of knowledge. As a book designer and a book historian from India, it was also important to establish that the history of the book tradition in India is not the codex. It's the scroll or the manuscript. So whilst the Murty printed books are in the codex form, the ambitions of the library are to provide digital access to these texts eventually. So an important aspect of the design was the acknowledgement of Indian text traditions. The history of text is incomplete without the history of the book. Authors do not write books, they write texts. And texts are shaped, transformed, and interpreted by publishers and editors or early printers, by designers and illustrators or scribes. And textual content is shaped in part by the form, the tools, materials, and technology that produce the form. So in our research, we sought to unpack the details of the printed page and the scribed manuscript in the Indian context to understand this in better detail. We also had to acknowledge the place of English in an Indian context, where most Indians are bilingual and are used to seeing English accompany Indic languages. It is important here to clarify something about the readers of Murty texts. The books aim to reach as wide an audience as possible. This means people coming to the text for purpose of study, but also for the purpose of reading for pleasure. Some of these readers will be fluent in the language, others might be second language speakers, or third language speakers, or simply not know English at all. So it was essential that access to reading was provided for all these different reader audiences equally. Concept and design. The classical in India, unlike many other parts of the world, is a contemporary concept, whether we like it or not. The past in India is embedded indelibly in the present. This proposal aimed to bring this to life by acknowledging the rich classical traditions of Indic literature, but in a contemporary setting. The design challenge was described by Dr. Ramanathan in one of our first meetings, and the aim was to get the Murty text to be perceived with the same lack of boundaries as Indian classical music, where the enjoyment of the text is not limited by its geographical origins. In music, polyphony is a texture consisting of 2 or more independent melodic voices, as opposed to music with just 1 voice, or music with 1 dominant melodic voice. The approach to the book design asks 2 questions. Can we design a book where the concept of symmetry is based on language rather than aesthetics? And can the content lead the form and so create a harmonious book design? Shown here are the different permutations and combinations possible. There are 6 different widths of text boxes available, which range from A, 218 points, to G, 234 points. whilst using one of the six different widths, the text box can be placed on the page in 28 different ways. And as the two languages don't have to be the same width, multiple variations are possible. So for example, one could use B1-7 for the English and C2-7 for the Indic. Ideally, every language would use only one set of combinations that could be applied to all the subsequent titles in that language. Through flexibility of column widths, interlinear space, and type size, the series design provides for very different structures of text, encompassing prose, poetry, and drama, and allows one to arrange the text and translation to their best internal logic while providing a bilingual reading experience. To use the example of the Devanagari and Latin script, the grid divides the page from an inner margin into multiples of 9 points. I wouldn't dare say this except you're really wanting such detail. The grid allows 6 units of distance between the base margin and the folio, and a text box for the Latin is 28 units, while for the Hindi it's 22. And the positioning of the elements on the page varies according to languages and the length of languages. So the system aims to highlight the nature of the text and put emphasis on intertextuality. Each page also has a subtly different layout that is determined by the length of the Indic language in relation to the Latin and the nature of the scripts to each other. Here, because of the Hindi poem and the amount of color on the page, the Hindi is set at 14 on 17.5 points, 1.5 baseline measure to the Latin, which is set at 9 on 14. With Pavana's story of Manu, the challenges were in part to ensure the color of the page was correct, and Fiona and I conducted a number of print tests together with all the typefaces to reach the optimum relationship between the Murty types and MCLI Antwerp. I know that John will speak a bit more in detail on the particular problems of the Telugu typeface, but for me, I will leave it as this. Sometimes you can bring things into sync, and Tita spoke a bit about it in his presentation, but often I find that in multilingual design, we find the push to try and find an exact sync between two very different scripts and writing systems often obliterate their individual characters. With the Murty Telugu, I'm pretty comfortable and happy with the individuality and difference that you see on the page. With Bhuleshwar's Sufi lyrics, the Gurmukhi key is set quite tightly to the baseline bridge to get a balance between the two pages. Again, because this is poetry, the Gurmukhi text is set at a slightly higher point size compared to the Latin, to enable a strong sense of color. The history of Akbar was thankfully set by Titus using Nassim. Titus used the series template and adjusted this to use the means suit the needs of the text. The history of Akbar is also the first prose text of the series, and Titus faced some particular challenges in the facing page translations. He's pushed the margin in the template as far as he could without going off the page to achieve a beautiful sync between the two pages. Working in publishing in India for some years now, you get used to the economical constraints and the creative decisions that can arise as a result of them. I mentioned that with the Murty typefaces, the series adheres strictly to Indian convention. There's no bold, no Indic, no bold Indic, no slanted, thank goodness. To keep the Latin on balance, we worked with regular and italic weights of the Antwerp, and sometimes this pushes the limits of what can be achieved with multiple typographic hierarchies. In this case, for example, we set the common text below the headline in 80% gray, and this is something that can be achieved both in the US and in India with not so great printing conventions. So color becomes a very important way of distinguishing. Achieving typographic harmonies was another challenge with very complex footnotes, and I've never been more grateful to work with John in this regard, who doesn't seem to flinch at any task that he's asked. I won't say too much here, except that, again, with the print test here, and I tried to work hard to achieve this level of color and consistency. What was important here was to acknowledge that the reader of the notes are more than the text in this book, is either likely to be a high-level scholar or a student studying the text. So essentially a reader who wants a no-nonsense sentence that reads smoothly, clearly, and efficiently. whilst there is a lot more of a nod to Indic traditions on the binding of the book jack and the jacket design, I thought we'd be fun to show you the little bits we sneaked into the interior design, like the running heads with the double dunder instead of a full stop between the chapter number and the diagrams. So where are we now? As we send season two shortly after print, we've exchanged 5,528 emails. And we're in the process of developing four templates: Telugu, Hindi, Sanskrit, Pali, Gurmukhi, and Urdu. I think we have done justice to the research that Harvard entrusted us to do, and that we're developing a series design that's pertinent to India's heritage and embraces the principles of unity and diversity. But now the real task of sharing the knowledge and developing the system with the input of others in the field begins. Thank you very much.
So just one more talk. I think I would have been a little less sleepy and probably a little more sober at that point, but we'll manage. So this is largely a show and tell presentation. It's kind of like a type specimen with some commentary added to it. We don't have a lot of time this evening to get into some of the technical stuff of, you know, open type layout programming, script itemization, cluster analysis. I'm sure that's going to be disappointing to some of you. Great relief for everyone else. So my aim is to give you something of a flavor of the Murty fonts and some idea of how they came to be. So as Fiona explained, Tiro was originally contracted by Harvard in 2011 to produce an initial tranche of five fonts to support typesetting and texting Bengali, Hindi, Punjabi, Sanskrit, Tamil, and Telugu. And the fonts were used in the Murty library books, and also, as Fiona said, as the book comes out in the script, the fonts are made available for no fee, non-commercial use, licensed by scholars and by anyone else who wants to use them. We've recently signed a second contract to produce additional fonts to extend the Sanskrit coverage and to support typesetting of Marathi in Kannada. The prioritization of the scripts and languages is dictated by the publication schedule of the series, although that's already been subject to a number of changes. As the series progresses, I'm sure this list is going to extend and virtual collection of events for all of the major indigenous scripts in the Indian subcontinent, and perhaps some of the resurgent historical scripts, such as Modi. So, although our primary contribution was to design the Indian fonts, my first job was to help Henrik Kugel extend Antwerp, the Latin type, to handle the transliteration needs of the text. So Fiona and I, with advice from Reina Kimmig at the University of Tübingen, specified a set of diacritics, and then Henrik and I worked together to extend these fonts with all of these. Rather than having specific Latin diacritic fonts for specific languages, the aim was to make sure that the fonts could handle anything that was thrown at them by the series. So this supports a number of different transliteration standards that are used by scholars for Indic, not just the ones that are used in the Murty library itself, and also for transliteration of Persian, which features very highly in Indian literature in the Mughal period. Getting technical for a moment. So the vagaries of Unicode mean that the Latin diacritic set in fonts is encoded in text with this peculiar mixture of pre-composed diacritic characters, which are indicated here in green, decomposed sequences of base letters with combining marks in red, and hybrid sequences of pre-composed diacritics with additional combining marks in orange. decided on the font end that we would support all of these pre-composed GIFs because we were dealing with a known and limited set rather than needing, as in something like the Brill font project I worked on, be able to support a generative system of arbitrary combinations. And because I'm a crazed completist, there's a full set of small cap plans in the region that I predict. And this was quite early on in the project, and the book design was still fairly preliminary at this stage. I wasn't sure what was going to be needed, but I didn't know that there were going to be small cap running headers, and I figured it's only a matter of time before one of those contains some transliterated name that we're going to need these for. So the transliterated diacritic, they occur in all of the introductory materials, the books, in some places in the English translation, in the footnotes. But occasionally they're also going to be used for the main text in the original language. So one of the goals of the project was that each of the original languages would be presented in the script with which it is most associated and which is most read by modern readers. That isn't always an easy decision to make. And in the case of Pali, which is the language of the early Buddhist canon, there is no one script associated with it. There is no obvious choice, and there are no modern native readers. And so the decision was made that this would be printed in a Latin transliteration. So here this is from the Theragata, which is a collection of ascetic poems written by early Buddhist nuns about 600 BC. If you're only familiar with the Californian version of Buddhism, this book is a great corrective. This is very, very austere stuff. Quite beautiful and moving, but yeah. So the first volume in the Murty Library is the Sufi Lyrics of Buddha Shah, written in Punjabi in the 18th century and edited and translated by Professor Shackle. Now, manuscripts of these poems, as I understand, exist in a number of different writing systems. These include Shamukhi, which is a variant of Perso-Arabic script, which is still favored for writing Punjabi in Pakistan. But in India, Punjabi is primarily written in the Gurmukhi script, and that's what was chosen for the Murty edition. Rasay was chosen for the Murty print edition. Electronic books have some interesting possibilities that have not yet been fully explored, one of which is that the same text could be presented in multiple scripts according to the preference of the reader. And in this specimen, you can observe some of the stroke modulation that Fiona was talking about and the letter construction based on manuscript models. The Gurmukhi script is one of the simpler Indian writing systems. It doesn't use complex conjunct forms and only a small number of subscript letters. So it made it a nice place to start working on the Murty type, since we're able to quickly mock up realistic looking pages with a comparatively small number of test glyphs. That gets to be a challenge when you're working on more graphically complex systems such as Devanagari and Bengali, because until you've made a fairly complete functional font, it's hard to realistically test it for balance against the Latin. One of the things you might have appreciated from the images so far is that Antwerp is a fairly heavy text base, which produces a pleasingly dark and warm presence on the page. But it means that the Indic types have to be similarly heavy, which, as we'll see, presented challenges for some scripts. Time for another technical aside. So, and this is an insight into some of the behind-the-scenes stuff that went into actually getting the books typeset. A few years ago, while I was working with Fiona on a Bengali typeface for the Ananda Bazar, the Truth in Newspaper Group in Kolkata, I discovered that OpenType layout engines were processing all features for Indic scripts at the discrete cluster level. And that meant that if you wanted to specify a contextual lookup that looked across cluster boundaries, the layout engines would never apply. You could put them in the font, they would never happen. I'm sort of horrified that people have been making Indigo the type fonts since 1919. Nobody seemed to have noticed that before then. I kind of think it wasn't until recently that we actually started trying to do typography with these Indigo fonts, rather than just having those kind of fallback things on systems. In April 2014, a lovely meeting in Seattle of various stakeholders, the shaping engine side of things. And they've agreed on a fix for this, and that's now implemented in Apple's core text engine in Yosemite and in the open source Half-Buzz engine. It's not yet fixed on either Adobe's or Microsoft engines, and particularly the Adobe one caused a major challenge for us because the books were being produced in InDesign. In Gurmukhi, the problem presents itself in this sort of way. So you get an above line dot, this is a nasalization dot, colliding with a shape that is on the following cluster. Because it's on the following cluster, how do we achieve this, this in the green, where the headline has been extended to allow a little bit more space between the marks above the line? Because we can't reliably address it across the via contextual lookups, what we ended up doing was putting these lookups that widen the length of the headline into non-contextual stylistic set features, and then we worked out a system to do a character level search in the text itself, to identify the places where the individual stylistic set features would need to be applied in order to achieve the results that we needed between clusters. I wrote the specification for a search algorithm, a small part of which is shown here, and Carsten took a program that it runs the script inside InDesign. So when the text has been gone through the editing process, it gets handed on to Rathna and the typesetter, they just run the script once and it goes through the entire document and applies these substitutions where it needs to. But yeah, it's an unfortunate workaround. At the same time as I was working on the Gurmukhi design, we hired Fernando Mello to work on the Murty camel type. Fernando's MA project here at Reading involved a very handsome Tamil text type, and we previously worked with him on the Tamil for the Nirmal UI font for Microsoft. So although Tamil was one of the first of the types to be designed, you're the first people outside of the project to see it. I think there was a change in the publishing schedule, so we could expect this to be released, I believe, in 2018 at the earliest. So there it is, and we look forward to having that at a later date. If you're familiar with the tradition of Tamil text types, you know the earliest ones were slanted based on a particular manuscript style, and this established convention was followed in Tamil publishing until very recently. But Rathna was adamant that she wanted an upright Tamil for the Murty type, and not only to better balance with the facing English text, also to provide a high quality design in this style for Tamil users. Having completed fonts for two relatively simple scripts, it was time to tackle the Devon Agri. As Fiona explained, we needed a design that would work for the initial Hindi volume and also be extensible to the more graphically dense texture of Sanskrit. And of course, it needed to balance with the dark presence of Antwerp. This is a specimen of the Murty Hindi typeface, and I'm particularly happy with how well the type performs alongside Antwerp in the extensive textual apparatus of the Surs Ocean volume shown in the lower right hand here. I could give you an entire presentation, take up most of the evening, on the subject of determining conjunct support needs and the methodology for Devanagari fonts. Suffice to say that it's an evolving process, and pretty much every time I pick up a Sanskrit book, I see some conjunct that I've not previously encountered. But one of the nice things about designing types for a specific series and for a specific test is that as each volume is going through the production thing, we can run analysis on it and identify all the conjuncts that appear in that book and test it against the font and make sure that we cover everything. I mean, that's great to be able to do that. But, you know, normally you design a font and you send it out there and you have no idea what text it's going to be used with. At least now, with this, we know that the primary purpose, we're hitting everything we need to hit. The Murty Sanskrit font not only contains many more conjunct ligatures than the Murty Hindi, it also contains different forms of select letters and ligatures, as Fiona was talking about, and I've shown a few more of them here. Some of these differences originate in regional preferences, and others reflect the evolution of simpler conjunct forms in Hindi, favoring horizontal arrangements. Now, OpenType provides a possibility to have language-specific variant forms and shaping within a single font. But we decided, because that technology depends on accurate language tagging of the text throughout an entire production workflow, it would be safer and easier for the typesetters if we made separate fonts. So there's a Murty Hindi font and a Murty Sanskrit font. They have different default forms and different default behaviors. So although the Murty Hindi font was released earlier this year along with the first of the book, the Murty Sanskrit font will be released next January to coincide with the publication of the first Sanskrit volume. Briefly, here's a comparison of Hindi and Sanskrit text, so you can observe the relative graphical density. Due not, of course, not only to the increased number of vertical conjuncts, but also to the different conventions of word breaking. Another aside. So, when Harvard first received the digital text from Ken Bryant for the edition of Sir's Ocean, this is what it looked like. There's a phenomenon that I've encountered with academics working with non-European languages, which is that sometime around 1989, someone gave them a floppy disk with a font on it, and they've been using it ever since. The problem isn't merely that the fonts tend to be not very attractive and often very amateurishly made, because you know, change the font, that's fine. The problem is that the underlying text is encoded like this. It's not Unicode. It's a hack of 8-bit ASCII code points. And like most hacks, non-standard, font-specific. So you know, there are multiple hacks for the same language, multiple fonts. Before Tim and Rathna could begin working with this text, it had to be converted to Unicode, which meant analyzing the encoding of the hack font, so figuring out which letters, ligatures, and marks were mapped to which ASCII characters, and then defining an algorithm to convert to Unicode dev library characters. To make matters worse, the hack encoding relied on visual order, while Unicode relies on phonetic order. So conversion not only involved mapping of character codes, which was sometimes many relying on one to many, but also reordering the results. And as with the cross-cluster context workaround, I wrote the specification, this part of it here, and Carsten Luca programmed it. And to date, we've had to create conversion algorithms for three different hack encodings to Unicode. That's just for the first 2 years of multi-library publications, and I doubt they'll be the last. But one of the reasons why Harvard is making the Murty fonts available to people to use is hopefully to wean them off these kind of hack fonts and make it easier for scholars to produce their own Unicode encoded texts. The entire presentation could be a technical aside about the Murty Telugu font. If you see my paper from TypeCon last year, you'll be familiar with the issues involved in the shaping and spacing of Telugu clusters, and I'm just going to talk about the design this evening. As Fiona mentioned, Telugu writing evolved in different materials and tool tradition from that to the broad Northern Indian scripts. Telugu manuscript letters are very thin and monoline, and what we see in the conventional stroke modulation pattern of Telugu typography is the influence of 19th century European tools and fashions. So the characteristic swelling line, dynamic contrast of broad and hairline strokes that are associated with the flexible one-year nib. And the distribution of this dynamic weight favors heavy strokes along the baseline and counters with lighter sides and hairline tops. Overall, the effect of this is to produce a light appearance of Telugu text that is difficult to balance with either Latin or indeed with Northern Indian scripts. I've already commented on the relative heaviness of Antwerp, and this is where it poses the greatest challenge. Simply put, neither Fiona nor I could find a way to bring enough weight into the Telugu design to properly balance with Antwerp, especially in print, without contravening the conventional proportions of weight distribution of Telugu, and also in so doing, affecting the optical size of the text by making the characters appear smaller. Of the Murty fonts that have been so far published, the Telugu is the one that my thoughts return to most often. I wonder if increasing the weight of the headlines by 2/1000ths of an M might improve things. I wonder if a very slightly increase the overall size might allow weight to be added without reducing the size of the characters. And Fiona keeps reminding me that some of the huge amount of kerning, a lot of which is contextually complex, could be improved. So I expect there'll probably be a Murty Telugu 2.0 font in the future. It's a very beautiful script, but design and technically quite challenging. Like the Tamil, Murty Bengali has not yet been released, and you're the first people outside of the project to see it. The first Bengali volume is a series currently scheduled to be published in January 2017, and will be released at that time. It's the first of the scripts in the series that I hadn't previously designed for. And so it was particularly pleasurable to work on because I was able to learn so much from Fiona in the course of the work. But particularly interesting to me was working out the weight of the headline and the vertical stem weights, because structurally a lot of the letters look quite similar to the Devon ivory, but they require a very different touch to get a nice texture and relationship to the other shape in the script. Some of the Murty Library editions contain notes for both the original text and the translation. So Rathna requested that we add superscript numerals for all of the scripts. Each font now has a full set of superscript digits, which are accessible via the OpenType Superiors feature, and they're spaced so that they can be used. Superscript numerals, and they're spaced so that they can be used alongside of words as references. I began the presentation talking about Latin fonts, and I'm going to end talking about Latin fonts. So Harvard's license who gave me this? Harvard's license agreement with Henrik for the Antwerp fonts does not include redistribution, of course, so it meant that we couldn't put the Antwerp glyphs into the Murty fonts that are being released. But I did want the fonts to contain a Latin set, both for some legacy technical reasons, and also so that users of the fonts would have access to the same set of transliteration diacritics and other things. So having spent a lot of time designing Indian typefaces to harmonize with Antwerp, I now needed to produce a new Latin typeface to harmonize with the Murty types. Although it's not quite a new Latin typeface. So I began with a type that I made about 10 years ago for the Society of Biblical Literature, which is in the S column on the left there, and reconfigured it as shown in the middle columns to be closer to the weight and vertical proportions of Antwerp, which is what the right-hand columns. There was no requirement to make it metrically compatible with Antwerp. I just have a similar presence on the page. And so to balance it equally well with each of the Indic scripts, both those that we have made today and those that we hope to make in the future.
Thank you. Will we be doing questions, Jerry?
Can the screen not?
Thank all four very much for the wonderful presentation. Everybody else for your patience here. You will notice that the bar is not closed. And we have booked the room and the terrace for the rest of the evening. Lawrence, the rest of the evening, not on your terms. But please stay on, enjoy each other's company, get a drink, and do walk up to people and ask them more and more stuff about the project. Thank you, everybody.